So, good afternoon, everyone. Now, we'll start a discussion on world history. Now, in world history, actually, when you look at your syllabus from world history perspective, I'll just tell you what are the important things to firstly, talk about in world history. In world history, in terms of your syllabus, sorry, not world history, post-independence history. Post-independence history in your syllabus, what are the important areas first? The important areas, देखिए, which book to refer? पहला तो आपका यही सवाल आ जाता बार-बार. तो there is that book, NCERT, 12th class. पॉलिटिक्स इन इंडिया सिंस इंडिपेंडेंस. ठीक है, इफ़ यू वॉन्ट टू रीड एनी बुक देन दैट इज़ द बुक NCERT 12th क्लास पॉलिटिक्स इन इंडिया सिंस इंडिपेंडेंस, दैट इज द NCERT दैट यू शुड रीड. ओके, इफ यू वॉन्ट, अदरवाइज I'll discuss with things with you in the class. I'll not dictate too much in post-independence. Okay, but there'll be just like there's been a PowerPoint for everything. I understand the world history PowerPoint is not uploaded, right? Today it will get, I'm 100% I'll get it uploaded today. And there will be PowerPoint presentation for this also, which will be uploaded and you can use that as a tool. My suggestion says that what we discuss in the class and the PowerPoint presentation, if you read that much also, more than enough. Even if you don't read the NCERT, but if you want to, then this is the book you must read. Nothing else, no Ramchandra Guha, no Bipin Chandra, no nothing. This is it. Okay? You can use this and the PowerPoint presentations that I give, that's it. Nothing else. Okay? Now, post-independence history gives 1 to 2 questions in the mains examination. That is there. Small but useful area, and anyways will help your understanding also. Now, what are the topics which are important here? See, the topics in post-independence history which are important, firstly, in the 1950s is the linguistic reorganization of states. And the creation of new states. इस पे बार बार क्वेश्चन पूछा जाता है मेंस में, इज वन इम्पॉर्टेंट टॉपिक एसे में, पोस्ट इंडिपेंडेंस हिस्ट्री, एवरीवेयर इट इज यूजफुल. सेकेंडली 1960s इज द टाइम व्हेन थ्री थिंग्स आर वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. नाइनटीन सिक्सटी टू, नाइनटीन सिक्सटी फाइव एंड 1971 वॉर. 1960 टू 1970, दिस इज द थ्री थिंग्स विच आर इम्पॉर्टेंट फ्रॉम योर एग्जामिनेशन पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू. वाई ईच ऑफ दीज वॉर्स हैपेंड एंड वट वॉज द कॉन्सिक्वेंस ऑफ ईच ऑफ दीज वॉर्स. सीधा सीधा दे कैन आस्क दैट वट वॉज द सिग्निफिकेंस ऑफ द ताशकंद अग्रीमेंट और वट वॉज द सिग्निफिकेंस ऑफ द शिमला अग्रीमेंट. द ताशकंद अग्रीमेंट हैपेंड आफ्टर द 1965 वॉर. द शिमला अग्रीमेंट हैपेंड आफ्टर द 1971 war. You should know these three major wars and their significance. Third is after 1950s and 1960s, the third major one that we are interested in thing is the 1970s onwards saw the emergence of a number of social movements in India, right? What are these social movements? There's a variety of social movement from the Chipko and the environmental movement to the women movements to the JP movement. That eventually led to the emergency of 1977. Okay. and a number of other movements. For example, 1960s onwards itself, there are other movements which began before also. For example, in the 1960s, there were the linguistic movements which began. So in movements maybe, they can ask you question in post-independence history. 1980s is a time when again two things emerge in a major way. One is the backward caste movements. 1970s was a time also when there were another movements, the farmer movements, especially after what? Green Revolution. Green Revolution happened after 1967, and there are a number of movements which emerged after this. There are farmer movements also. The farmer movement, the linguistic, the Chipko, the JP, the women movements. 1980 is the time when there is the backward caste movements. Mandal Commission, right? Late 1989-90 Mandal Commission, VP Singh government implemented 27% reservation for OBCs. Right, so all those things, the rise of political parties like SP, BSP, backward caste movements and political parties. Then also 1980s is the time when there is a good amount of insurgency growing. The Kashmir to theek hi theek hai, chhodiye usko, but the Punjab region, and you have Blue Star and the assassination of Indira Gandhi 1984. So insurgency Punjab also 1970s to 1980s. In Assam there is violence and conflict ultimately in 1970, and you know there is the All Assam Student Union, which led the protest, which ultimately led to the Assam Accord and other things also. So these are also a few other things which are important. So agar sawal aana hai, it will come from these areas. These are the broader topics. That's all that you need to do. So it's actually not really interest, we are not really interested in political controversies, who said whom to, what to whom, and all those things. We are looking at major political, social or economic developments that happened in every decade, and which were the important ones, what triggered them, and what was their significance. It's only mains oriented topic. In 1950s, there is one more topic that is there, and that is land. 5 year plans. So 5 year plans, anyways, we'll in general talk about 5 year plans. And in economics also, you would have, you know, broadly discussed what was 5 year planning and what was the weakness in 5 year planning. If you want, I'll explain to you today itself what were 5 year plans and what were weaknesses in 5 year plans, what were issues with 5 year plans, what was their achievement, what was their weakness. Okay, anything else? Is this much clear? Theek hai. तो ये सब हमें करना है. और एक चीज़ याद रखिए, इस पर नोट्स बनाने में ज़्यादा फोकस ना रखिएगा, जस्ट फोकस ऑन अंडरस्टैंडिंग. इफ़ यू वॉन्ट टू राइट सम की टर्म्स, यू राइट विथ मी. आई विल नॉट डिक्टेट लाइक आई वॉज डिक्टेटिंग इन वर्ल्ड हिस्ट्री एट्सेट्रा, क्योंकि एक तो ना समय है, पर समय से भी ज़्यादा इंपॉर्टेंट, इट इज़ नॉट वर्थ योर टाइम. यू आई डिस्कस विथ यू, यू रीड फ्रॉम द पावर पॉइंट प्रेजेंटेशन, दैट वुड बी मोर देन यूजफुल. इज दिस पॉइंट क्लियर? देखिए, हर सब्जेक्ट को पढ़ने का एक तरीका होता है, एंड उसको द वे यू स्टडी दैट सब्जेक्ट डिपेंड्स ऑन द वेटेज ऑफ दैट सब्जेक्ट. यू कांट बी यू नो जस्ट गिविंग टू मच टाइम ऑन वन सब्जेक्ट इररिस्पेक्ट ऑफ द फैक्ट दैट द वेटेज इज नॉट दैट हाई. यू गेट इट? सो लेट्स स्टार्ट विद द 1950s. टुडे वी विल टॉक ओनली अबाउट 1950s. ओके, the 19 or the 1950 to the 1960 decade. Theek hai? Now 1950 to the 1960 decade, that is what we are talking about first. Dekhiye, 1947 there is freedom and partition. But after 1947, this freedom and partition, but after 1947, the first major challenge that emerged, there were many challenges, or the first major challenge that emerged was the integration of princely states. But it was not the only challenge. The other challenge was to ensure, the second major challenge was also to do what? Accommodate diversity and ensure, accommodate diversity, which diversity? Cultural, linguistic, and religious. To accommodate diversity, and that would be cultural, linguistic, and religious. And ensure territorial integrity of the state. To prevent what? Another partition. See, in the aftermath of 1947, one of the major preoccupation was to ensure that, firstly, princely states. There were, you know, we discussed in independence also that there were a large number of princely states which enjoyed autonomy under the British. And after the British left India, the question was about whether these princely states will get independence, or whether they will join India, or whether they will join Pakistan. Either, and you see, a number of princely states, there were 565 big and small princely states, and out of these princely states, some of the big ones, for example, was Junagadh, was Hyderabad, was Jammu and Kashmir, and there were other smaller ones also like Bhopal, etc. Okay. Now, many of these princely states expressed desire for independence. For example, the Nizam of Hyderabad wanted an independent state of Hyderabad. So was the ruler of Jammu and Kashmir, Maharaja Hari Singh. He also wanted independence. So there was a question of integrating these states. Okay. Otherwise, there was a fear of balkanization, or the division of India into a number of smaller territories. At the same point of time, there was another issue that India had just witnessed the partition. Okay. Another priority was to ensure, to not just integrate the princely states, but ensure that no other region demands independence, and ensure the territorial integrity of the system is what? Maintained. That is what was there. So these were the first and the second major challenges. Okay. And one could say that accommodating diversity was another challenge. The third challenge The third major challenge was also there. And the third major challenge was what? To ensure economic what? And equitable what? Development. See, India was a country which attained independence in 1947. Literacy rate in India was less than 20%. Economically, India had low agricultural productivity. Low agricultural productivity, so much so that we were dependent on import of food grains. So, there was low agricultural productivity. That was one problem. isn't it? That agricultural productivity was low and we had to import food grains. On the other side, we lagged any major industrial base that's there. On the third side, low literacy, poor healthcare, ye sab bhi tha. And there was another fourth challenge, sir. ये जो मैं आपको बता रहा हूँ ये आप चैलेंजेस ऑफ नेशन बिल्डिंग में भी लिख सकते हैं. दीज वर द चैलेंजेस ऑफ नेशन बिल्डिंग फॉर इंडिया इन द 1950. ओके, द फोर्थ मेजर चैलेंज वॉज व्हाट? एनीबडी? व्हाट कैन बी अनदर चैलेंज? टू इंस्टीट्यूशनलाइज the practice of what? Democracy. To institutionalize the practice of democracy in a largely illiterate society with deep social what? So deep social divisions. See, India had adopted a new constitution, but it was important to ensure that all major political groups respected the constitution and were willing to put faith in the democratic setup. That it's not that okay if one party won the election, it accepted the election result, other party said no, we don't accept the election result, let's do election again. If you see in many countries which have struggled to be democracy, there's a common problem. Every time election happens, opposition party says nahi, we don't accept the election, we want re-election, or army takes over power. Whereas India had this challenge that many, see, when India moved towards democracy and universal giving vote to all, right to vote to all, and putting in a democratic setup, almost every other Western political thinker said that democracy will not work in India because these people are illiterate, deeply divided as a society, there will be no respect for democratic principles. People will neither political parties nor people will accept such a democratic setup. Okay, and so democracy will not last. Either there will be dictatorship or there will be a military coup or something of that sort. Democracy won't last in the country. Okay, so it is this reason that the challenge was a constitution was there, but what was needed was that all major political sections showed the willingness to abide by the constitution. Okay, so conducting free and fair elections and ensuring that all major political groups abided by the electoral results was also a what? Major challenge. Okay, and all these challenges had to be taken care of. And all these challenges were there at the same time. It's not pehle ek challenge aaya, fir dusra aaya, fir teesra aaya. Okay, jab pareshani aati hai to sari ek saath hi aati. That is there. So jaise aapke liye mains ki pareshani hai, ye bhi padhna hai aur ye bhi padhna hai aur ye bhi padhna hai, everything is there now. Now that is where you see Patel played an important role in the integration of princely states. I'll discuss that in more detail. Patel played an important role in the integration of princely states. Patel was the deputy prime minister and then the home minister, right? And played an important role in the integration of princely states by negotiating with the princely states directly. Secondly, to accommodate linguistic and cultural diversity to accommodate linguistic and cultural diversity. What did India have? India adopted a linguistic reorganization of states or not, and I will discuss its detail also. To accommodate religious diversity, what was there? Yes, the principle of secularism or not, and also providing protection, additional protection to minorities or not, that is also something which was there. To ensure economic development, what did we have? 5-year plans and state led planning. And to ensure equitable growth, what did we have? Socialism. Yes, the objective of socialism was to reduce what? Economic inequalities. And the fourth challenge was to institutionalize the practice of democracy, and for this there was an effort to put in free and fair elections. So now is it clear the challenges and the steps taken for what? For dealing with those challenges. ठीक है, आप चाहें तो ये लिख लीजिए. Okay, because this is a very useful way. थोड़ा सा लिखने से क्या होता है, दोपहर में नींद नहीं आती है. लंच सेशन, एवरीबडी स्लीपी. सो एट लीस्ट दिस गिव्स यू अ सिंपलर वे ऑफ लुकिंग एट एवरीथिंग. Social issues, Saurabh sir has started discussing. So even social issues will overlap a lot with post independence. Okay, क्योंकि वो सारा post independence period में ही हो रहा है. देखिए, दिमाग में नोट्स ऐसे ही बनाए जाते हैं. अगर आपसे पूछा जाए दैट क्वेश्चन लाइक दिस इज आस्क्ड दैट द फर्स्ट डिकेड आफ्टर इंडियन इंडिपेंडेंस पोज मल्टीपल चैलेंजेस टू द बर्थ ऑफ इंडियन डेमोक्रेसी, कमेंट. तो बस आपको ये याद रखना है चैलेंजेस हैं क्या. इसके आगे तो ऑटोमेटिकली यू कैन build on it. Is this point clear? Yes? Written? Chaliye. Now let's come to a further discussion. Of 1950s, I will first talk about the integration of princely states. Theek hai? The integration of princely states. The integration of princely states under Patel, who played an important role, was, you know, was to the strategy was to follow a policy of persuasion. Strategy was to follow a policy of persuasion. ठीक है, and The strategy was that they would persuade the princely states. That's one part of the strategy. The other was also to provide or to reassure princely rulers and partly allow them to retain their what? Princely estates and privileges, meaning their palaces or their palaces or the properties, etc., you know, and privileges, and also the what was called as a, many of them were to be also extended a monthly support by the government, that was called the privy or the privy purses. Okay, now, and the third aspect of the strategy was that if persuasion failed, resort to the use of force as a last measure. Resort to the use of force as a last measure. So, most of the princely states were persuaded with these two. Okay, most of the princely states were persuaded with these two. However, there were some states which could not be easily persuaded, and the ruler of Junagadh in the Gujarat region, the ruler of Junagadh wanted, he was a Muslim ruler of Junagadh, and he said that no, we will not join India, we will join Pakistan. It is at this point of time that, but the majority of the population in Junagadh was the Hindu population, and it supported joining India. Following which, the Indian government did put pressure on the ruler of Junagadh to hold a referendum. A referendum was held, and the people voted in favor of joining India. Following which, the government threatened to move in the army. The ruler of Junagadh escaped, you know, he went to Pakistan, and Junagadh was annexed by India. The next that is there to talk about is the Nizam or Hyderabad. In 1947, the Nizam of Hyderabad signed a standstill agreement with the government of India. See, in 1947, as India attained independence, the ruler of Hyderabad, the Nizam of Hyderabad, signed an agreement saying that we can now discuss. So, he signed a standstill agreement. He said that India will not annex Hyderabad till both the, or India will not try to forcibly annex Hyderabad. And Hyderabad, before merging with India, would negotiate the terms of the merging. That Hyderabad, the rulers of Hyderabad wanted to bargain better, to even secure a certain amount of autonomy over their internal rule, and even because the Nizam of Hyderabad initially said that we want independence. When this was ruled out, they said we'll like to join Pakistan. When that was also ruled out, then the question was, the only option that they were largely left with was joining India. But they argued that they would negotiate with the government and they wanted a standstill agreement, that till a agreement is reached between both sides, Indian government will not forcibly try to annex whom? Hyderabad. It signed a standstill agreement and the Indian government agreed not to forcibly annex Hyderabad. Okay. And the standstill agreement was signed with the government of which India, and India agreed not to forcibly annex Hyderabad. However, the Nizam of Hyderabad was at this time, was not a very popular ruler. Okay, the Nizam of Hyderabad at this time was not a very popular ruler, and two major political parties in the region, two major political parties in the region were the Communists and the Congress Party. If you remember from Indian history, I told you the which movement, the Telangana movement. The Telangana movement of 1946-47 happened, in which the Communists were successful in redistributing land to the peasants. And because of this, the Communists were popular. And so was the Congress Party, a relatively popular state unit of the Congress was operative in Hyderabad. These two major political parties argued for unification with India. Moreover, what happened? Argued for unification with India, and moreover, the Nizam was relatively unpopular. During this period in where? In Hyderabad. The Nizam was relatively unpopular in Hyderabad. Now, it is at this time that the Nizam unleashed the Razakars, which were the private militias of the Nizam, to suppress the political parties and political protests against his rule. Okay, and a significant amount of violence broke out in Hyderabad. It is at this time that Patel saw an opportunity which could justify the intervention of the Indian army. See, the point is, the Indian government had given a commitment in the form of the standstill agreement that India will not use force to annex Hyderabad. And it is when violence erupted in Hyderabad and when the private army of the Nizam unleashed a significant amount of violence on people, the Indian government argued that it is necessary to send in the army to maintain law and order. And this was the justification for the Indian army's intervention. The Indian army was sent in, and within a span of 2 weeks, the Nizam of Hyderabad agreed to sign the instrument of accession. To sign the instrument of accession and thus be annexed by whom? India. So, following this, as I just told you, that the army was sent in to suppress violence, and Hyderabad was what? Next, चलिए ये दो तो हो गए. अब टॉपिक आई डोंट लाइक टू टीच, जम्मू एंड कश्मीर. ओके, सो अब हमें इसको अनेक्स करना ही है. जो कमी रह गई वो मोदी जी पूरी कर देंगे. इन द सेम ईयर 1947, अ स्टैंडस्टिल अग्रीमेंट was also reached with Jammu and Kashmir. Importantly, Jammu and Kashmir was different from the two other areas because it was neighboring all India, China and Pakistan. हमें कई बार 1949 में हम ऐसे बोलते हैं जैसे चाइना तो था ही नहीं, बस इंडिया एंड पाकिस्तान ही था और चाइना भजिए चल रहा है. And I'll not bring China too much into the picture because it will unnecessarily complicate you, not required at your level. But 1947 was decided that the state of Jammu and Kashmir, which was a erstwhile princely state ruled by the Hindu Maharaja Hari Singh, where the majority of the population was Muslim, ये सब आपको पता है, ठीक है? J&K signed a standstill agreement with whom? With whom? The government of India and the government of Pakistan. That no party, J&K, the Hari Singh was clear. He wanted to maintain. He wanted that his princely rule or his princely state must remain independent. And he said that okay, we can talk a way out. And he signed the standstill agreement with both India and Pakistan that no side, either or India or Pakistan, will try to do what? Use force to annex Jammu and Kashmir. So this was the standstill agreement. Abhi 1948, a year later. Now here, okay. So if Hari Singh wanted to maintain autonomy, Hari Singh wanted to maintain what? Independence. The view of the Muslim League was this. Muslim League said, Jammu and Kashmir is a Muslim majority area. All Muslim majority areas must belong to Pakistan. So, Jammu and Kashmir is something that belongs to or should belong to Pakistan. So, Muslim League in Pakistan sought to establish control over whom? In 1948, ये कहानी अब आपको यहाँ से पता है ना? That नहीं तो I'm telling broadly. So, 1948, what happens is that Pakistan broke the standstill agreement and did what? Sent in armed tribal groups to do what? To Jammu and Kashmir. To forcibly take what? Power or control. To forcibly take power or control in Jammu and Kashmir. To simply do what? Bring about a military coup. Capture the city of Srinagar. Depose Hari Singh. And capture Jammu and Kashmir. And unite it with Pakistan. Okay. That is a surgical strike. Okay. So, Pakistan is doing the surgical strike. Now, Now, this is what is there. So, the Pakistani troops, armed tribal groups, Pashtun groups, etc. were also moved in and they started closing in on Srinagar. Okay. Now, it is at this point that Hari Singh now appealed to the government of India. Hari Singh now appealed to the government of India for military support to drive out whom? These armed groups coming from Pakistan. The Indian government said that we cannot intervene unless we have a legal basis to send in the army. And the legal basis is you must sign the instrument of accession. Okay. So, yes, in 1948, the instrument of accession was signed by Hari Singh, now under this instrument of accession it was said that Jammu and Kashmir region would retain its autonomy till a final settlement is reached. And in the meanwhile, would still a final settlement is reached. And this became the basis for deploying the Indian army in the region. The Indian army was quickly airlifted to Srinagar and countered the Pakistani troops on the outskirts of Srinagar and eventually pushed them back. India raised the matter, Jawaharlal Nehru, and India raised the matter where? In United Nations in 1948. India raised the matter in United Nations in 1948. The United Nations said, India raised the matter, but United Nations said that firstly, the UN mediated a ceasefire saying that both sides should stop the fighting. Or the fighting immediately in the region. Then UN said, not India, UN said that a referendum or a plebiscite must be where? Organized in Jammu and Kashmir, India said, but first situation must return to normalcy. अरे इधर उनकी आर्मी खड़ी है, इधर हमारी आर्मी खड़ी है, तो कैसे होगा वोट? Situation must return to normalcy. For this, UN said that for holding the referendum, firstly, Pakistan troops must withdraw from the region. Pakistan troops must withdraw from the region. Law and order must be restored. Indian troops must be reduced to what? To minimum. These were what? The conditions for holding These were conditions for holding what? Plebiscite. In conditions, when these conditions are fulfilled, then a plebiscite can be held, is what UN said. Okay. Now, what was the condition in 1948 when the ceasefire happened? Is that okay? Okay. Okay. So, what was the condition then? The condition was, okay, I know that this, कैसे बनाऊं लेकिन, suppose this is Jammu and Kashmir, right? So the situation was this, that somewhere this was the area which, see, when the tribal armed group from Pakistan came, they were coming close to Srinagar, the Indian troops pushed them back, and when the Indian troops pushed them back, there they went behind this line, and these areas were under, the northwest areas were under their control. That is why the UN mediated the ceasefire. So that is what was called as the line of control. Okay. The borders in the Rajasthan and the Punjab region and in the Gujarat region is called the international border, because it's a settled border. Okay, this is the unsettled border. Line of control matlab where are the Pakistani troops placed and the Indian troops placed. So this is what was the situation. Now the referendum, if had to happen, then the Pakistani troops must withdraw. The Pakistani troops must withdraw behind the LOC and behind this, the Gilgit-Baltistan and the whole, you know, the areas under their control. And first they must withdraw. Then law and order must be normalized. They must withdraw, and then India will reduce the troop strength to minimum. India will not completely withdraw the troops. Why would Pakistan withdraw troops? Jo mila hai wo bhi chala gaya to. Pakistan did not withdraw troops. Pakistan did not withdraw troops. India said we will also not withdraw troops. So, khatam ho gaya, yahi khatam ho gaya mamla. So, that is there. And, but India said we had still signed that instrument of accession, in which we said that Jammu and Kashmir will be allowed to retain autonomy until a final settlement is reached. It is at this time that 1948-49, a long time associate of Jawaharlal Nehru and the Congress, Farooq Abdullah's father, Sheikh Abdullah, the National Conference Party. He formed the National Conference Party, he had formed that before itself. But in 1949, the National Conference Party took out protests against Hari Singh. Hari Singh was forced to give up the throne of Jammu and Kashmir following popular protests. And Farooq Abdullah's father, Sheikh Abdullah, became the Chief Minister of Jammu and Kashmir in 1949. Lekin that is when the Constitution Assembly was going on. The question was where to accommodate Jammu and Kashmir with its whole business of autonomy. Okay, tab wahin pe aa gaya Article 370. The Constitution Assembly debated Article 370 for 5 months. Heated debates on both the sides. Some said that you give a constitutional status to Jammu and Kashmir under Article 370, where it will be allowed to retain its autonomy on all matters except on defense, telecommunications and foreign relations. Okay, and on all their internal matters they will enjoy complete autonomy. That is what is at the core of Article 70. So under this will retain their autonomy till and thus for this time, till this is happening, army, foreign policy and communication would lie with Delhi, whereas would be under the control of Delhi. Clear? So that is it. Now the question was, now that this deadlock was reached where neither the Pakistani side withdrew its troops and neither and the UN proposal of holding a referendum or a plebiscite did not materialize, but the Indian government has had given the assurance that it will ascertain the wishes of the people. Indian government said ki haan, we will, Jawaharlal Nehru said in the parliament that India will ascertain the wishes of the people. He did not use the word referendum or a plebiscite. Referendum or plebiscite means where the people will vote on this issue, but he said no, we will ascertain the wishes of the people. Elections were held in Jammu and Kashmir and Farooq Abdullah's father Sheikh Abdullah won the elections and he became the chief minister. Then article 370 was, he said, and because the government of India had given the this standstill agreement in 1950, what happened is in 1950 article 370 was incorporated where? Within the constitution, signifying what? The unique status of Jammu and Kashmir. Signifying the unique status of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, after this, it's a bit even more complicated. Now, but a final settlement was yet to be reached, and area, the northwest areas of Jammu and Kashmir were under the control of Pakistan. Okay. Now, Sheikh Abdullah wanted a whole unified Jammu and Kashmir, and he said that Jammu and Kashmir is yet to make up its mind whether to join India or Pakistan. Okay, that is there. So this was a messy situation. Needless to say, Farooq Abdullah was in power till 1953, and by 1953, however, so firstly, Article 370 was introduced in 1950. It is within Article 370, under Article 370 of the Constitution, Jammu and Kashmir was now to have its own constitution. And which said that no laws except on the three areas that I told you, defense, army, etc., no laws made by the government of India would apply to whom? Would apply to where? Would apply to Jammu and Kashmir unless ratified or unless agreed upon by the J&K Assembly or the Constitutional Assembly. They will have their own assembly. Unless their assembly agrees, no laws made by the government of India will apply. Okay, to Jammu and Kashmir. Similarly, by that is there, and Jammu and Kashmir would have its own constitution and its own prime minister. So Sheikh Abdullah, who was the first chief minister, also became the first prime minister and the only prime minister of Jammu and Kashmir. प्राइम मिनिस्टर भी बन गए, वो चीफ मिनिस्टर भी बन गए, प्राइम मिनिस्टर भी बन गए. सो दैट इज द सिचुएशन टिल 1953. नाउ बाय दिस टाइम द रिलेशंस बिटवीन जवाहरलाल नेहरू एंड शेख अब्दुल्ला पार्टली डिटोरिएटेड. नाउ शेख अब्दुल्ला वॉज एट दिस पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम टॉइंग विद द आइडिया ऑफ दैट कुड ही डू समथिंग टू इंश्योर. सी शेख अब्दुल्ला नेशनल कॉन्फ्रेंस, शेख अब्दुल्ला वॉज वेरी क्लियर फ्रॉम द वेरी बिगनिंग ऑफ हिज फर्स्ट क्लैरिटी वॉज दैट दे वुड नॉट जॉइन पाकिस्तान एट एनी कॉस्ट. बट शेख अब्दुल्ला, सो दैट वॉज ऑलवेज क्लियर. बट शेख अब्दुल्ला इन 1953 वॉज लुकिंग एट द पॉसिबिलिटी दैट कुड ही ऑब्टेन इंडिपेंडेंस फ्रॉम इंडिया ऑल्सो. ओके, एंड देयर वर बैक चैनल टॉक्स बिटवीन शेख अब्दुल्ला एंड द पाकिस्तानी गवर्नमेंट. ओके, एंड इट इज एट दिस टाइम दैट रिलेशंस वर डिटोरिएटिंग विद न्यू डेली एंड विद जवाहरलाल नेहरू. एंड दस वेन दस ही वॉज प्लेस्ड अंडर अ हाउस अरेस्ट हु शेख अब्दुल्ला एंड जेल्ड फॉर द नेक्स्ट 11 years. मोदी जी से बहुत बड़ा बड़ा लोगों ने, इट्स नॉट दैट जवाहरलाल नेहरू वॉज ऑल रोजी आइड एंड ही इज द वन हु गेव हु वॉज रेडी टू गिव अवे कश्मीर ऑन अ प्लैटर. ही जेल्ड शेख अब्दुल्ला द मोस्ट पॉपुलर लीडर ऑफ जम्मू एंड कश्मीर एट दैट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम फॉर द नेक्स्ट 11 years. ही वॉज नॉट रिलीज टिल द डेथ ऑफ जवाहरलाल नेहरू फ्रॉम जेल. जवाहरलाल नेहरू ऑल्सो, द नेहरू ऑल्सो केम फ्रॉम कश्मीर, इज ऑल्सो कश्मीरी पंडित. So it's not that they were like yare le jao, right? So even that was there, and for 11 years he was in jail. Another chief minister was put in place over a period of time during 1957, and eventually later you see that slowly but steadily the Jammu and Kashmir government, which came after Farooq Abdullah, agreed to extend slowly but steadily other laws which applied what to the rest of India, also to Jammu and Kashmir. Gulzari Lal Nanda, who was the Home Minister also, said that Article 370 is like a funnel. It's like a funnel from, so देखिए मैं इसलिए बता रहा हूँ, Article 370 is like a funnel through which laws made by the central government will pass to J&K. Many pointed out that Article 370 was supposed to be a temporary provision. Gulzari Lal Nanda in 1964 said, why do you want to cut away the funnel? Practically every law, as long as the J&K government is agreeing to it, can be extended. And that is what has happened in the past 14 years. Why do you want to cut away the funnel? One law, however, that was passed and introduced in the constitution under the 9th schedule was what? Under the 9th schedule, another one was Article 35A. Under this article, it said that the Jammu and Kashmir government could identify its permanent residents, and only permanent residents would have the power to buy property, and the Jammu and Kashmir government could extend additional privileges to them. And if you place it in the 9th schedule, so is it susceptible to judicial review? No? Yes? At that time, it was not susceptible to judicial review. After Keshav Nanda Bharti, they said everything is susceptible to judicial review. But those put in the 9th schedule before 73, they said they can stay. Yahi hai. From what I remember, this is the story, right? So this was not susceptible to judicial review, and so even if fundamental rights are being violated, but if it is kept under 9th schedule, it won't be susceptible to a judicial review, was the position. अभी मेरे को पता है सुप्रीम कोर्ट में चल रहा है कुछ कुछ 35A और आर्टिकल 370 पे, बट दैट इज व्हाट इज द सिचुएशन. ना ये पूरी कहानी मैंने आपको क्यों बताई है, वी से आपने पढ़ा है अभी तक, मैम टॉट यू फेडरलिज्म, फेडरलिज्म देन क्वाजी फेडरल, डिड शी ऑल्सो टीच एसिमेट्रिक फेडरलिज्म, यस नो, two people are saying yes, rest are saying no, who's right, two people, asymmetric federalism, article 370, article 35A in case of Jammu and Kashmir. But other articles like article 371 and other articles all are symbolic of asymmetric federalism. Federalism is what the center and states will enjoy freedom and will be equal to each other. But accepting that India has a lot of diversity, accepting the basic recognition that the subcontinent has a lot of diversity, within the federal provisions there will be accommodation of unique demands of different regions owing to the unique circumstances in which they, owing to the unique circumstances either under which they joined the Indian state, or the unique circumstances can be with respect to their language, topography, region, culture, whatever. Okay, so for example, under article 371 etc. that apply to northeastern states, there are restrictions on outsiders buying property in northeastern states also, okay, or autonomous councils being made in northeastern states. So that is asymmetric federalism. The political scientist Louis Tillon calls that India is not merely a quasi federal state, it is also, it also practices asymmetric federalism, okay. And so to that extent they say that the whole concept of asymmetric federalism meant that under the federal structure, the unique demands of states to retain autonomy could be accommodated under the constitutional structure given what? Given the unique what? Conditions. Given the unique conditions under given the unique conditions under which they acceded to India or to accommodate linguistic, cultural, geographical diversities etc. Are there are many schemes for which hilly states get a 90s to 10 funding pattern or not, and there are many schemes for which other, for the same scheme, while hilly states may get 90s to 10 funding pattern, other states may get 50:50 or 75:25 funding pattern. Why is that? Because we understand that though under the federal, the basic principle of federalism is to ensure that state autonomy is maintained, some states may need added protection or may need autonomy to maintain their own existence. That is it. That is asymmetric federalism. So, yahi to sari debate hai. Kai log bolte hain ki article 370 is a aberration. It must be removed. They argue ki aur kisi state ko to ye suvidha uplabdh nahi hai. Pehli baat, aur states ko bhi ye hai. Many other states in northeast, in Himachal also, outsiders cannot buy property. Okay. And in northeastern states also that is there. That's the case with Jammu and Kashmir also. So, such restrictions apply in a number of states. But even if there are, say, a couple of states in which these restrictions apply, it is a feature of Indian federalism itself that those states are expected to retain their autonomy, not all states are treated equally. Okay. And that is partly owing to history, partly owing to geography, partly owing to their cultural identity related issues as well. Okay. That is there. Is this much point clear? You may or may not agree. Abhi aaj aap ko jo jo hatana sab hata di. 370, 35. Main to keh raha hu 35 hi hata diye, fir sare Delhi wale aake wahan property khareed lenge. That is there. Main to bol raha hu Pakistan walon ko bhi khol dena chahiye, wahan bhi jaake property khareed lenge. नहीं तो वहां एकदम कराची पे एकदम बीच साइड चिल करेंगे, मतलब कराची वी कैन मेक द नेक्स्ट गोवा. नो, एक बार आप वहां चिल करिए, एक बार आप गोवा में चिल करिए, एकदम सही चिल होगा. एंड बाय अ बीच साइड हाउड इन कराची एज वेल. सो दैट इज देयर. इज दिस मच क्लियर? नाउ सो एनीथिंग दैट यू वांट टू फर्स्टली आस्क हियर. So, what we were thus discussing was this, in terms of integration of princely states, these three areas. Yes, and this, as I was telling you, was one of the first primary challenges. Clear? Yes.
So, what about the Aksai Chin region
at that time? So that is why I didn't go towards the Aksai Chin side, and I said we'll not bring in China into the picture. But now that you ask, slowly but steadily, after 1949 and in early 1915s, in the border Aksai Chin region, in the border regions of Aksai Chin, Aksai Chin was actually a no man's land. There is a difference. The Gilgit-Baltistan and the POK region were those areas where there was habitation or people used to live. Aksai Chin was a barren piece of area where nobody used to live. Okay. So, India claimed the control over Aksai Chin area and so did China. There was no settlement on this issue, but India said, so there are two lines here, the McDonald line and the McJohnson line. कोई नहीं पूछेगा आपसे. बट देर वॉज अ सर्टेन अमाउंट ऑफ कंटेस्टेड क्लेम इन दिस रीजन, बट नोबडी लिव्ड. नाउ सीक्रेटली आफ्टर द 1950s द ब्रिटिश, द चाइनीज स्टार्टेड स्लो कंस्ट्रक्शन इन दीज एरियाज एज दे वॉन्टेड टू कंट्रोल द तिब्बत रीजन. नाउ वन ऑफ द सिंगल सिंपल थिंग इज दैट थ्रू द Aksai Chin रीजन दे वॉन्टेड टू कंस्ट्रक्ट अ लैंड रूट टू कनेक्ट डायरेक्टली the Tibet region to the Xinjiang region. Okay. And that is something that was to slowly and eventually start in the 1950s, but not something that they publicly accepted, nor India had any troops placed in the region. And this situation came to light only when they actually majorly got involved after 1955-56. Under Mao, because in 1949, even China has just witnessed the communist revolution and Mao just came to power, and thus immediately consolidating over Tibet, his hold over Tibet was his priority, but that was something that would eventually take time. That is it. Clear? So that's happening. Anything else? Sakshikam Valley region. This is the region that Pakistan also had an unsettled border with China. 1962 India-China war happened. 1963 Pakistan and China settled their border dispute. And the Sakshikam Valley region was given to China by Pakistan, which is a part of the Gilgit-Baltistan region. कोई फायदा नहीं है, फालतू ही लड़े मरे पड़े. Okay. So, अभी उधर वो सियाचिन भी है, तो उधर आ जाइए. इधर इधर हर सी फ्रैंकली वी सिटिंग इन दिल्ली, हमको क्या फर्क पड़ रहा है ना? ये फर्क तो आप बोल नहीं सकते, आप जैसे देशद्रोहियों का ही नहीं फर्क पड़ता है, हमें तो फर्क पड़ता है. राइट. But if you look, it is such a heavily militarized region. Pakistani army is there, Indian army is there, China wale bhi wahin baithe hain, sab baithe. Okay. So that is there. It's not a very good place to be born in with so much army, north, south, everywhere. Now, is this much clear? Now, that's the first issue that I've told you, that 1950s we are dealing with this issue. Okay. Now, eventually, that's the other issue is the, I told you, the next issue is the linguistic reorganization of states, right? That accommodating linguistic and cultural diversity, and that is the linguistic reorganization of states. Let's come to that. Yahan se hum ek bahut bada टॉपिक भी खोल सकते हैं जो इम्पोर्टेंट भी है और जो मैं आज तक समझने की कोशिश कर रहा हूँ, एंड दैट इज द क्रिएशन ऑफ न्यू स्टेट्स. बड़ा कॉम्प्लेक्स है मैटर एक्चुअली, लेकिन मेंस में क्वेश्चन भी आया हुआ है. देयर वाज ऑलरेडी क्वेश्चन इन द मेंस एग्जामिनेशन दैट हैज द क्रिएशन ऑफ न्यू स्टेट्स हेल्प्ड इन द ग्रोथ ऑफ दीज स्टेट्स. ठीक है, चलिए लंबा सवाल है, ढंग से पढ़ते हैं, ये बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट एरिया. ओके, इज दिस मच क्लियर? आपको कोई मजा नहीं आ रहा है? अभी मजा आएगा. ठीक है, कितना लिख दिया हमने? नाउ व्हेन वी डिस्कस the linguistic reorganization of states, is pe seedha seedha question aa sakta hai, and this is a part of another topic that we can say is the creation of new states in India. Linguistic reorganization of states and the creation of new states in India. Dekhiye. In 1920 as well as in 1945, Congress had twice issued a resolution where they said that demands of, you know, that once India attains independence, we will reorganize Indian administrative units or states on the lines of linguistic homogeneity. That we'll create new states by ensuring that people who speak the same language have one common state. What advantages it offers is, firstly, it offers the advantage of administrative convenience. That if people who speak one common language are largely in one state, then the work of that state can be carried out in that language. also clearly understanding that language is an important part of an individual's identity. Language is an important part of an individual's identity. So, in 1945 also, Congress issued a resolution where they promised to accommodate what? The linguistic aspirations. Of whom? Of different regions to reorganize states. Where? Post in independence. The reorganized states post independence. Now, but in 1947, what happened? Independence and partition. Now, with partition, the game changed completely. Now, the immediate concern after partition was to prevent another partition. And what was feared was that if linguistically homogeneous regions were, you know, reorganized to create states, these linguistic states may even demand independence. So, their first fear was to ensure that territorial integrity of the country is not compromised at any cost. But many, those who were eagerly waiting for creation of new states after independence, now wanted, and who knew that Congress had earlier promised, now wanted Congress to stand by its promise. But neither Jawaharlal Nehru nor Vallabhbhai Patel, both were not really keen on doing what? Both were not really keen on linguistic reorganization right now. What they said was, right now was needed was stability to ensure territorial integrity. But given popular demands and demands even within Congress, in 1948, the Dhar Commission, he was a retired judge of the Allahabad High Court, and under him the Dhar Commission was appointed to consider demands. For what? For linguistic reorganization. What did the Dhar Commission say? The Dhar Commission rejected the demand outrightly and said that the focus has to be on ensuring security and territorial integrity. Okay, but following Dhar Commission's rejection of the linguistic reorganization, there were widespread protests. And under public protests and pressure, in 1949, the central government established another committee, the JVP committee. Jawaharlal Nehru, Vallabhbhai Patel and Pitabhai Sitaramaya. This committee also said that immediately it would not be possible to accommodate what? To do linguistic what? Linguistic organization because we have many other challenges right now. right? And but the demand can be considered at a liter, but the demands can be what? Considered at a liter. What? Stage. So what did they say? They left the door open. Ki baad mein dekhte hain, abhi ruk jao. We can look at the demand at a later stage. Not now. Not now. Because of the other challenges that they argued and ensuring the territorial security, because there was always this concern that what may start as a demand for a creation of a separate state may end up as a demand for the creation of a separate what? Nation. That is their super biggest concern. Now, in 1951, okay, in 1951, a Telugu Congress leader Potti Sirimalu, he sat on a hunger strike, sat on a 63-day hunger strike and ultimately died, demanding the creation of a Andhra Pradesh. Following which what happened? AP or Andhra Pradesh was created, merging the coastal areas with the state of Hyderabad. The state of Hyderabad then roughly corresponded to the state of Telangana right now. Jaisa Telangana right now is, that is roughly what was Hyderabad state. And they also merged the coastal areas to create Vishal Andhra or Andhra Pradesh. Okay, that is what was there. However, this soon led to other demands. When other regions saw that pressure banaya to ho gaya, then other regions again kick started the demand. 1952 was the time when who? When 1951 was a time after which, by when elections had concluded, and now following popular protests again, another committee was created. Which committee was that? Yes, 1953, the Fazal Commission. And under the Fazal Commission, again, it gave its recommendation, and these recommendation is very important actually to understand the broader issue of creation of new state. It said, okay, linguistic reorganization of states on the principle of what? Linguistic homogeneity. On the principle of what? Linguistic homogeneity. But here is the point. The Fazal Commission said that the reorganization of states will keep the linguistic homogeneity criteria in mind, but that's not the only criteria to be kept in mind. That's not the only criteria to be kept in mind, in the sense that territorial integrity related concerns, if are there, they will also be kept in mind. What is also required is to ensure that the financial implications of creating new states and financial implications of creating new states and maintaining our and ensuring that these states retain what? Financial what? Auto. These states retain what? Financial auto. नॉमी मतलब आपने यू क्रिएटेड अ न्यू स्मॉल स्टेट बट द स्टेट डज नॉट हैव द एबिलिटी टू जनरेट अ सिग्निफिकेंट पोर्शन ऑफ द रिसोर्सेज नीडेड फॉर इट्स एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन देन दैट स्टेट विल नेवर बी फाइनेंशियली ऑटोनमस इफ अ स्टेट इज नेवर फाइनेंशियली ऑटोनमस कैन देयर बी फेडरलिज्म सर आप फेडरलिज्म में एक चीज हमेशा पढ़ते हैं फिस्कल फेडरलिज्म फाइनेंस कमीशन ये सब क्यों है इज टू इंश्योर दैट स्टेट्स गेट अ रीजनेबल शेयर ऑफ द रेवेन्यू कलेक्टेड एंड दे हैव इनफ रेवेन्यू टू इंप्लीमेंट देयर ओन प्रोग्राम यू क्रिएट अ न्यू स्मॉल स्टेट व्हिच डज नॉट हैव एबिलिटी टू रेज फाइनेंसेस टू फाइनेंस इट्स ओन स्कीम देन हाउ कैन देखिए जैसे दिल्ली सरकार कह रही है एल महिलाओं को फ्री में देंगे मेट्रो राइट सो द दिल्ली गवर्नमेंट इज सेइंग दैट वी हैव फिस्कल स्पेस हम अपना पैसा से लेके दे रहे हैं टिकट सेंट्रल गवर्नमेंट से नहीं मांग रहे सो इट इज फिस्कल स्पेस इफ यू डोंट हैव फाइनेंशियल ऑटोनॉमी स्टेट कैन नेवर बी इंडिपेंडेंट सर जस्ट लाइक अ ह्यूमन बीइंग कैन नेवर बी इंडिपेंडेंट विदाउट फाइनेंशियल ऑटोनॉमी स्टेट डेफिनेटली कैन नॉट बी इंडिपेंडेंट सो ही सेड सो दे आर्ग्यूड दैट फाइनेंशियल इंप्लीकेशंस ऑल्सो क्रिएटिंग न्यू स्टेट्स आर इंपॉर्टेंट बिकॉज यू क्रिएट अ स्मॉल स्टेट विच इज ऑलवेज डिपेंडेंट ऑन द सेंटर then it is not actually a federal, it's not based on federal principles. So, these three are definitely important abiding principles. Linguistic reorganization is one of the important principles that can be looked into, but not at the cost of the other two. Theek hai? Yes. So, no, actually the Dravidian movement, I'll come to the Dravidian movement and Tamil Nadu eventually later. In the 1960s, the Dravidian movement really gains force and we'll come to the Dravidian movement. But this is the recommendation. On the basis of this, 16 new states were created by reorganizing older states and three or four centrally administered areas were चलिए 14 by reorganizing older states. The point is ये हो गया एक तो reorganization. So this is largely based on what linguistic criteria. Now I am for one moment we are not getting the detail कि 1960s में for example there is further another round of creation of new states in 1960s. For example, when Punjab and Haryana are separated and these two are Pepsu states say Punjab and Haryana are separated and they are created. 1970s mein Assam mein se all the other areas are carved out as newer states. Sikkim is integrated. Bahut cheeze hain. Facts nahi ratna hai hame. Hamara main objective ye hai that the first round of creation of new states happened largely on which basis? Linguistic basis. Okay. Though other criteria were also kept in mind. However, the next major round of reorganization of states happened where? Which year?
छत्तीसगढ़,
झारखंड. सो लेट्स फर्स्ट अंडरस्टैंड व्हाट एक्सप्लेन्स द क्रिएशन ऑफ दीज स्टेट्स. ये जो टॉपिक है इसका कोई एक आंसर नहीं. देर इज अ वेरी वेरी क्लासिक बुक जो मैं बहुत टाइम से पढ़ने की कोशिश कर रहा हूँ, मतलब 10 पेज पढ़ता हूँ फिर बोलता हूँ कभी और पढ़ता हूँ. इट इज बाय लुई टिलन ओनली. इट्स अ पोस्ट डॉक्टोरल वर्क ऑन एवोल्यूशन ऑफ इंडियन स्टेट्स, रीमैपिंग इंडिया. ओके, किताब पढ़ने की जरूरत नहीं है. एडिटोरियल इज, यू कैन फाइंड बुक रिव्यूज ऑफ दिस बुक इन द एक्सप्रेस. आप गूगल करेंगे इंडियन एक्सप्रेस हिंदू में 2014 या 15 में. लुई टिलन हैज ऑल्सो रिटन अ नंबर ऑफ आर्टिकल्स इन द हिंदू एंड एक्सप्रेस. रीमैपिंग इंडिया मैंने मंगाई तो किताब बड़े जोश में थी, बट आज तक खत्म नहीं करी है. तो आप तो ना ही मंगाए. ओके, ना पढ़ेंगे आप इसे. ओके, सो बट इन दिस शी हैज इन डिटेल एनालाइज द क्रिएशन ऑफ दीज थ्री न्यू स्टेट्स. ओके, अपार्ट फ्रॉम री लुकिंग एट the earlier reorganization also, and she has taken a bet at saying what would reorganization will, she has also tried to predict the future by saying that will there be creation of new states in India, if so on what basis, and how many number of states in India are enough. Okay, she estimates that India is big enough to have at least 50 states. अभी तो 30-31 पे ये गाड़ी जो भी है अभी 50 तक जा सकते हैं आराम से. ओके, गिवन द साइज द इंडियन स्टेट पॉपुलेशन और लॉट ऑफ दीज थिंग्स. सो इट्स मतलब इट्स अ कॉम्प्लेक्स मैटर. लेकिन इस पर आपको मेन में सवाल पूछा हुआ है. एक बार तो ये पूछा था आई थिंक लास्ट टू लास्ट ईयर दैट हाउ हैव द न्यू स्टेट्स, डिड द क्रिएशन ऑफ न्यू स्टेट्स इंश्योर दैट दीज स्टेट्स हैव फेयर्ड बेटर. ओके, ये विच न्यू स्टेट्स आर वी टॉकिंग अबाउट, दीज थ्री न्यू स्टेट्स. ऐसे ही ऐसे पे एक टॉपिक आ चुका है दैट क्रिएशन ऑफ न्यू स्टेट्स इशूज एंड चैलेंजेस. सीधा सीधा ऐसे पे टॉपिक आया हुआ है. आई डोंट रिमेंबर द ईयर बट आई थिंक 2014 और 15 दैट वॉज द टाइम आई थिंक वेन द तेलंगाना. विद हम तेलंगाना पे भी आएंगे, आते हैं उस पर भी आते हैं. आई विल ट्राई टू एक्सप्लेन टू द बेस्ट ऑफ माई एबिलिटी विच इज डिसेंटली इनफ फॉर UPSC. बट आई एम टेलिंग यू आई हैव नो डेफिनेट आंसर, क्योंकि लुई टिलन ने पूरी किताब लिखने के बाद कंक्लूजन में लिखा देयर इज नो डेफिनेट आंसर. जब उनके पास नहीं है तो हमारे पास तो है ही नहीं. ठीक है, एकदम ही क्लियर है. लेकिन आंसर लिखने के लिए हमारे पास बहुत है. सो द क्रिएशन ऑफ दीज थ्री न्यू स्टेट्स, व्हाट डू यू थिंक एक्सप्लेन्स द क्रिएशन ऑफ दीज थ्री न्यू स्टेट्स? व्हाट वॉज द डिमांड दैट ड्रोव द क्रिएशन ऑफ दीज थ्री न्यू स्टेट्स? रीजनल एस्पिरेशन लाइक झारखंड एंड ट्राइबल पीपल. सो दे डिमांडेड, सो दे डिमांडेड अ सेपरेट रीजन फॉर ट्राइबल पीपल और अ डिमांड ड्रिवन बाय लेट्स से एथनिसिटी. ओके, सो वॉज एथनिसिटी द ओनली फैक्टर फॉर झारखंड? इकोनॉमिक, वट इकोनॉमिक? मिनरल्स, कोल्स, एटसेट्रा, वट एवर. सी पार्ट एक्चुअली इकोनॉमिक डिमांड्स वर ड्रिवन ऑल्सो, देर इज फर्स्टली अ मिक्स ऑफ इकोनॉमिक डिमांड्स एंड ऑल्सो एथनिसिटी. द ट्राइबल्स इफ दे हैव अ सेपरेट स्टेट ऑफ देयर ओन वेयर ट्राइबल पॉपुलेशन इन मेजॉरिटी, इट इज लाइकली दैट ट्राइबल लीडर्स वुड इमर्ज ऑन द पोलिटिकल सीन एंड दैट वुड provide them the opportunity to make laws to ensure that tribals are not alienated from their resources or their land. That's one. The other economics is that Jharkhand was a part of Bihar, and so most of the resources extracted from Jharkhand or revenue generated from the economic activities in Jharkhand were utilized for the growth of Patna or other areas of North Bihar, right? So there is what? Inequitable regional growth within the state. Second major factor. That's for Jharkhand. What about Chhattisgarh? Again, partly the same things. Chhattisgarh, again, tribal dominated, mineral rich region, part of Madhya Pradesh, large part of the resources and the revenue generated went to the capital and the Madhya Pradesh region, whereas Chhattisgarh lagged behind in development. There are intra-state inequalities. That's there. So that explains for Chhattisgarh. For Uttarakhand, partly intra-state inequality, but also importantly topography. That Uttarakhand is a hill state region, hilly region, and partly the concerns of the hill people were often neglected at the cost of the mainland region. But there's another thing about Madhya Pradesh and especially Uttar Pradesh. What is that? Yes? Population. Let's say a better thing is the size of the state. Partly driven by population and partly driven by geographical area, is that they are huge states. So the idea was that these huge states meant that often these far away areas of Chhattisgarh or Jharkhand or Uttarakhand were located far away from the capitals, and what was often out of sight was out of mind. Okay, that large states were the ones in which certain regions were often neglected. So, a confluence of all these factors is what explains the creation of new states in Uttarakhand. There is a mix of ethnicity, there is a mix of demands for control over resources, there is also the neglect of regions within state, and also the idea that large states are relatively inefficient. If you create small states, it will engineer rapid economic growth. Why was so? Because there were small states like Punjab. There were small states like Punjab. There were small states like Kerala. And these states had done better than many other states. So many also said that small states do better than large states in terms of economic growth. So all these three or four factors are said to have worked together in a demand for creation of new states. Is this point clear? So if you want, you can write that down. Is broadly that the factors which explained creation of new states. Factors which explain the creation of new states. Factors which explain the creation of new states were, one, intra-state disparity in terms of development, whether in education, health, infrastructure. Or the diversion of resources away from these regions, meaning which regions? Which is the Jharkhand, Uttarakhand regions. The unique factors related to ethnicity, and the unique factors related to ethnicity, for example, the tribal dominated areas aimed to establish control over their resources especially minerals and other things, mineral rich region. And lastly, the hope and the assertion that smaller states were likely to witness what? Better or rapid economic growth. And partly what? India's constitution, does it make it easy or difficult to create new states? Easy or difficult? Easy, right? I mean, even if the state does not agree, it can be carved out into 2-3 as many parts. Name bhi, matlab ye ho gaya, aap naya state bhi bana do, naam bhi jo mane kuch rakh do, existing state ka naam badal do, jo karna hai kar do, right? The Indian constitution allows that. It doesn't ensure the territorial integrity of the existing states, right? So there is no such thing. Now, so even the Indian constitutional provisions made it easy to create new states. But this is what we called as the second phase of reorganization of Indian states or not? The first phase was what? Linguistic. But the second phase, was it linguistic? No. Partly ethnicity, but partly intrastate disparities. Partly the desire, partly motivated by ethnicity, partly motivated by intrastate disparities in development, but also partly motivated by the desire and the assumption that small states will witness better economic growth. So it is the post-linguistic phase, isn't it? Yes? Post-linguistic then who comes? 2011 onwards, kya? Telangana? Dekhiye. Now, the demand for creation of Telangana. See, the whole Andhra Pradesh region is a Telugu speaking region. Yeah, right? And it includes what? The two regions. What? What you call as the Telangana and the coastal Andhra Pradesh region. And both speak the Telugu language. The Telangana region was earlier a part of the state of Hyderabad that was ruled by the Nizam. And coastal Andhra Pradesh region was earlier a part of, before, you know, Hyderabad, before Andhra Pradesh was created as a state in 1951. Coastal Andhra Pradesh was a part of what? And Telangana was a part of Hyderabad, and both these areas were merged, and this was called the Vishal Andhra. So that's there. ठीक है, ये तो आपको previous history था. 2011, the Telangana region is what? What is the Telangana region? It is in the interior. It is relatively water, low agricultural, what? Water deficient and low agricultural productivity. Matlab the economy is, you know, so in terms of its water deficient and low agricultural productivity, and economically it has lagged what? Behind whom? Coastal Andhra Pradesh. Again, intra-regional or intra-state economic disparities. One of the common accusations of Telangana was that the resources generated from this region or the taxes generated from this region were diverted largely for developmental activities in coastal Andhra Pradesh. And it is this demand which historically also, actually there are partly cultural differences also. Okay, in the sense that I have not told you this, but the Telangana region is much more similar culturally also to the Marathwada region of Maharashtra. Chale chhodiye, koi baat nahi, rehne dete hain, itna detail ka zarurat nahi. Okay, so basically one of the main demands for the creation of Telangana was rooted against, again, in the perceived disparity between Telangana and coastal Andhra Pradesh. Eventually, student agitations, protests, supported by political party. Dekhiye, ye fact to maine nahi bataya. The creation of new states in Chhattisgarh was supported by political parties, and Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, etc. was supported by political parties. The creation of Telangana, KCR, TRS, Telangana Rashtra Samiti, supported by political parties. What you see is that in 1999, when new states were created, major important political parties, particularly the BJP, supported the creation of these new states. Because according to their calculation and their political arithmetic, if these new states were created and they supported the creation of these new states, they are likely to win elections in these states also. Okay, so political elites also have to support the demand. It's a complex mix. Okay, so all of this related in, but now here is the point. There was a demand raised in the Telangana issue, that when Telangana demand erupted, demands in other regions also erupted. In fact, demands were ongoing in other regions also. Which other areas? Darjeeling, borderline, to theek hi hai, bade aur areas pe aate hain. In Maharashtra, big states, let's go to the big states. Vidarbha. Demand for creation of UP, four states, demand for creation of four new states. Are Harit Pradesh, is in Harit Pradesh, they said kya? West UP, Purvanchal, Purvanchal matlab east. Then Bundelkhand, then Braj Pradesh, central. ठीक, अभी रुक जाए, इससे पहले आप कुछ पूछें, मैं कोई एक दो चीज़ें बताने दूँ, फिर बात करेंगे. रीजनल पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज ऑपरेटिंग इन वेस्टर्न यूपी लाइक अजीत सिंह्स आरएलडी, वेयर देयर इज व्हाट अ गुड अमाउंट ऑफ इरिगेशन, नॉट जस्ट दैट. ठीक है, इरिगेशन मतलब, इरिगेशन मतलब हाई एग्रीकल्चरल प्रोडक्टिविटी. तो अजीत सिंह एंड आरएलडी ये दे सपोर्टेड क्रिएशन ऑफ न्यू स्टेट्स. बात तो ये भी हुई कि मायावती भी तैयार थी, यू नो देर ऑल्सो लाइक ओके इफ वी क्रिएट फोर न्यू स्टेट तो हैज बिकम नेशनल पार्टी ऑल्सो. सी इलेक्टोरल अर्थमेटिक इज अ वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स थिंग इन द सेंस दैट दे वॉन्ट दैट दे वुड बी एबल टू यू नो इफ एरियाज वेर द बैकवर्ड कास्ट आर डोमिनेटिंग इफ दे क्रिएट दैट एरिया दे विल बी एबल टू विन द इलेक्शन देयर रिलेटिवली इजी. बहुत कॉम्प्लेक्स मैटर है एक्चुअली. इलेक्टोरल अर्थमेटिक इज वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स टू अंडरस्टैंड वाई डिफरेंट पोलिटिकल पार्टीज आर सपोर्टिंग that, but that is there. But also irrigation and their high agricultural growth. Many said that you know many of these western UP elites they said ki we generate revenue and we are if are the revenue generated from our region is reinvested in our region then our growth will improve further. देखिए बड़ा सिंपल सा बात है. दैट दे आर सेइंग इज दैट इफ वी क्रिएट अ स्मॉल स्टेट वेस्टर्न यूपी फ्लरिशिंग एग्रीकल्चर इफ ऑल द रेवेन्यू जनरेटेड फ्रॉम दिस रीजन इज री इन्वेस्टेड इन दिस रीजन द ग्रोथ ऑफ दिस रीजन विल बी इवन फास्टर. बुंदेलखंड ने बोला कि वी आर ड्रॉट प्रोन, हमें तो कोई सुनता ही नहीं है. झांसी ऑल दीज रीजन आर बुंदेलखंड रीजन ड्रॉट प्रोन ऑलवेज निग्लेक्टेड. इनको भी चाहिए. So there were these reasons. Vidarbha ka aapko pata hi hai that again it is the interior region of Maharashtra. Gujarat mein bhi hai kya demand? Saurashtra. Isn't it? So these are also dry regions which have lagged behind in development. Sir, what are you seeing? In the 21st century, the demand for creation of new states, a common underlying development is the rise of intra-state inequalities, the perceived misgovernance and corruption, and the underlying belief that if they create new states, the economic growth will improve. However, thus it can also creation of new states can also create more issues as well. Sir, new states. States share what? Border with each other, but they also share rivers. So Vidarbha or coastal Maharashtra have the dispute anyways over what? Water. You create new states, you may open up new problems as well. Also, will all these demands for new states, will they be financially viable? Has to be assessed. Whether these demands, so that is why what has been said is that while considering demands, for new states, firstly what should be done? What has been suggested is a new SRC, a States Reorganization Committee, must be constituted. And it should not happen that and it must consider all demands in which manner? In a comprehensive manner and it must do what? It must do what? Establish underlying principles and criterias. On which, what will be done? On which demands would be kya? Evaluated. Matlab aise nahi ki aap muh utha ke aa gaye. That we want new state, we want new state, tod denge, phod denge, we want new state. The commission will give a set of principles and criteria. When they are fulfilled, only then can a new state be made. And such principles and criteria must be evolved so that what is there? Aisa na ho that there are charges of political favoritism. That because BJP is in center and BJP thinks that by creating new state, say in Uttar Pradesh, it can benefit, but not by creating in Maharashtra. So it approves creating new state in Uttar Pradesh but not in Maharashtra. Ye nahi hona chahiye. Okay, otherwise that's a problem. And also jo criteria honge, a useful guide is what? The SRC of 1956 itself. The Fazal Committee recommendations were implemented 3 years later in 1956. And just like there where we had said that they said that linguistic criteria is one criteria. These are post-linguistic demands. Ab yahan pe linguistic se zyada important has become what? Post-linguistic demands. So, comprehensive criteria must be ensured, arrived at. But ensuring what? That financial autonomy of states is maintained. Also, one has to understand that is it actually a demand? Is it actually a cry for creating new states? Or is it a cry for ensuring equitable development within states? For ensuring equitable development within states, is there any constitutional mechanism already? What? देखिए दो तीन चीज़ें. एक तो देर इज एक चीज जो आपने पढ़ा है स्टेट फाइनेंस कमीशन इजंट देयर स्टेट फाइनेंस कमीशन टू इंश्योर दैट फाइनेंसेस आर डिवोल्ड अकॉर्डिंग टू द क्राइटेरिया पॉपुलेशन ज्योग्राफी विद इन डिफरेंट रीजन विद इन अ स्टेट राइट दैट्स वन थिंग अदर थिंग आर देर आर ऑलरेडी डेवलपमेंट काउंसिल्स फॉर डिफरेंट रीजन फॉर एग्जाम्पल फॉर विदर्भ रीजन विद इन for Vidarbha region within Maharashtra or for Saurashtra region within Gujarat, there are already already development councils, and these development councils are autonomous, supposed to be autonomous bodies created under Article 371 sub clauses. Okay, so these institutional and constitutional mechanisms must be effectively put in place to ensure that there is more equitable development within a state. So, हम ये नहीं बोल रहे हैं कि नया state बनना चाहिए कि नहीं बनना चाहिए, वो हमारी क्षमता के बाहर है. We are only saying that the reorganization committee must be put in place, which keeps in mind which evolves principles. They can be principles related to fiscal autonomy of states, and also distribution of what? Natural resources like what? Water or rivers must be considered by it. Moreover, existing constitutional mechanisms such as what? State finance commissions must be consulted or autonomous councils under Article 371, for example, in Saurashtra, in Gujarat, or in Vidarbha, in Maharashtra region, must be done what? Must be empowered to address intrastate disparity. Clear? Any other doubts? तो ले रहा मैं पहले गिव अप हो गया जीवन में कि बस सर अब जो बोलो मान लेंगे, बनाना है स्टेट बनाओ, नहीं बनाना है मत बनाओ. नो, दिस इज अ फेयरली डिसेंट एनालिसिस, स्पेशली फ्रॉम योर एग्जामिनेशन पॉइंट ऑफ व्यू, टू इंश्योर दैट एटलीस्ट यू आर एबल टू मीट द डिमांड्स ऑफ द आंसर. एनीथिंग यू वांट टू आस्क? क्लियर? So if you see, I've told you two major things in the important issues that I told you that are important from your examination point of view. I told you, right, that this linguistic reorganization was important. We discussed this, and the creation of new states also this. And also I told you about the initial 1950s, the Hyderabad, the Telangana, and the integration of princely states. That was another topic of 1950s which is important. One small thing if you want to talk is the land reform. Lekin wo land reform baad mein baat karte hain, kal karte hain thoda bahut land reforms ke bare mein, broader idea on land reforms. Aur 62, 65, 71 ek ek decade ko ek ek mein karne ki koshish karte in one lecture. Okay, that is that. Anything you want to ask? Thank you.